Well, thanks, Caitlin, for that interesting and informative report about how technology is going to allow us to be even more screwed up than we already are. I'm John Perry, along with my fellow philosopher at Stanford, Ken Taylor. We're coming to you from Oregon State University.
Our guest today is a professor of history here at Oregon State University. He's author of Promise and Peril, America at the Dawn of a Golden Age. Please welcome to the Philosophy Talk stage, Christopher McKnight Nichols.
Are you willing to go with that new subtitle?
Yeah, I'll go with it.
Chris, your work focuses on our need for public awareness of what governments do, a kind of 20th century idea, open treaties openly arrived at, but also, correlatively, the sphere of privacy for what we do. Well, how did you get interested in these topics when you were a kid? Did you kind of have a little fear that you were being watched all the time? You have a very intrusive mother or something like that?
Not quite, but actually, yes, it's a longstanding set of issues in my life. I think it goes back at least to high school when I was editor of my high school newspaper, the official paper, and also a satire magazine. And in the context of that, the faculty and administration often censored what we were putting out there. And sometimes for good, right, juvenile sorts of statements that kids often make, and sometimes for ill, the sort of penetrating criticism that only students at a school can really understand about that institution. And it gave me a real appreciation for the kind of essential conundrum of the leaker or of the empowered representative of the media. You know, what should you do? How should you disclose to the public? And perhaps do you not have as much information as you ought to have to make those disclosures?
Wow. Did you know that Edward Snowden and Daniel Ellsberg were both editors of their high school newspapers?
Oh, I did not.
Yeah. I have no idea either.
All right.
So, in your expert opinion, sounds like you're the person to ask, the current state of privacy in America, is it as bad as people think, or is it even worse?
Well, I think it's even worse, frankly. You know, historians, we don't tend to trade in absolutes. But in this case, I think we can be quite definitive with an absolute here and say that, in fact, in human history, there has never been more surveillance of individuals by the state and individuals by private entities, corporations, as there is today. And this is a global phenomenon. It's not just an American one, although you could argue that it's even more insidious in a representative democracy. And here, the disclosures of Snowden and other topics we'll be getting into really make clear the wide-ranging parameters of the oversight that we're feeling or not feeling every single day.
But I assume one of the reasons is more pervasive than any time in history is because we have more capacities. I mean, the roving report said we're marrying ourselves to these machines that are constantly collect data. You know, I've got my own jawbone up on my wrist right now. I never had the thought, what if the insurance company starts buying this information? You know, I mean, it's just possible now in a way that it never was before. Isn't that right?
Absolutely, yeah. But that doesn't mean that it necessarily follows. Because it's possible, because we have the technology, doesn't necessarily argue that that should be the end.
Have you ever known any technology that could be used for some problematic end that wasn't used for that problematic end? Has there ever been a technology that, you know?
There have been. In fact, in the STS, Science, Technology, and Society classes, it's very often remarked on in human history that for cultural values, for political values, for religious values, societies have turned back against these things. One classic example that I've often taught is ancient Egyptians preferred pure metals to alloyed metals, even when alloyed metals could cut better.
Okay, societies. Some one or two societies every now and then
okay.
have not gone over the brink, right? Is that what you're telling me? Or is it often? I mean, it just seems to me this is with us to stay and it's going to get worse.
Fair enough. I think that's probably true. Nevertheless, again, that doesn't mean that we shouldn't have a spirited public discussion about the parameters of it. Perhaps
okay,
we could minimize it.
And that's what we're going to do on this show. This is Philosophy Talk coming to you from Oregon State University in Corvallis. Our guest is Christopher McKnight Nichols, author of Promise and Peril, America at the Dawn of a Global Age.
How much would you risk in order to keep your privacy? Are you willing to have the NSA read your email if reading everyone's email significantly reduces terrorism? Or is the right to privacy worth letting a few terrorists slip through the net?
Privacy, privacy, and security, along with questions from our live and public-minded audience when Philosophy Talk continues.
Very good.
I'm just an average man with an average life. I work from 9 to 5. Hey, hell, I pay the price. All I want is to be left alone in my average home. But why do I always feel like I'm in the twilight zone? And I always feel like somebody's watching me. And I have no privacy.
Welcome back to Philosophy Talk. Do you feel like someone's watching you? Well, they probably are. I'm John Perry.
And I'm Ken Taylor. Our guest is historian Christopher McKnight Nichols from Oregon State University, and we're in Corvallis, Oregon, thinking about the new surveillance society.
Do you care if some agency keeps track of your phone calls and emails, as long as they don't abuse this knowledge? Or is the very idea of this information being collected repugnant to you? You can join the discussion by stepping up to the microphones in front of the stage and taking your private thoughts out of your head and burying them for us all to see.
Okay. So, Chris, so back to what we were saying before. Look, moving forward, like it or not, we're in this new age of surveillance. I think it's just going to get worse and more powerful. These powerful techniques at the disposal of government and corporations, they can be... Now, given all that, here's a question. What actually does it mean? What does a right to privacy mean in a context like that? In the old days, you know, I could go for a walk in the pastoral England or something and expect to be alone. Mm-hmm. I'm never alone.
Right? Absolutely. You're not alone if you've got your smartphone, you're being tracked. What is a right to privacy? And this gets at a sort of fundamental philosophical question, a historical one, about change over time, about our expectations as individuals, and whether or not there really is a right to privacy properly construed. One question that I would have for you all is, you know, should we think more about privacy rights, say, in terms of other types of rights, property rights, or right to having your body secure, mm-hmm. right? So Fourth Amendment kinds of rights. We should think about these questions of search and seizure, perhaps, instead of a more narrowly defined right to privacy.
Well, that's a good question. I guess if I wanted real privacy, I would go to Malaysia and get on an airliner, but that aside, when we look in the Constitution, the word privacy does not occur in the Constitution. There's a lot about freedom of speech and freedom of thought, but that's a freedom to act, to say what you believe, to publish what you believe, to make the private public. Then in the Fourth Amendment, you're supposed to be secure from unreasonable searches and seizures. They don't use the word privacy, but it sounds like privacy. The key thing, I think, for today's world is what do they mean by effects? They say mm-hmm. Your property and effects. Right. So you might have thought that effects were things that you created, mm-hmm. Like letters. But then wouldn't that apply to email? I think our buddy... Rand Paul has been making that point. From a historian's point of view, is that a valid point? Is all this looking at email just plain unconstitutional?
Right. So Rand Paul recently filed this class action suit arguing that the warrantless or single warranted wiretapping in this sort of way is unconstitutional.
Single warrant means they got one warrant that covers everybody in the U.S.
Right. Yeah. So it's not discriminate, but rather indiscriminate. They're gathering all of our information at the same time. and without any probable cause. And this is what, if you go back to the constitutional debates about ratification, 1788, you can go to the debates in Virginia, for example, and see a real neat contrast between Patrick Henry and Edmund Randolph arguing whether how much secrecy there should be and whether or not we should trust our government. And regardless of the era, I think that's the question at stake here for us as we debate this subject.
So let's go on that. Let's follow up on that. So you might ask yourself, why does the government have such an interest? Forget about the corporations for a second. I know what their interest is. It's the profit motive, right? They want to profit off all this information. Why would the government have such an interest in gathering all this information about people? I can think of reasons. In East Germany, the Stasi apparently had a file on any potential East German who was a potential enemy of the state, right? Who had contact with the West or belonged to a certain organization. Massive file. In totalitarian governments, though, many people regard the government as illegitimate. Okay, there was a time in the U.S. when many people regarded the government, you know, the anti-war movement, the civil rights movement. I could see the government regarding those people as potentially objectors to the legitimacy of the government and then wanting to gather information. But those days aren't here. People are hostile to this or that party, but the government as such, the state as such, there aren't that many people going around wanting to overthrow the U.S. state among the Americans. Why does the government feel a need? It's not like the Soviets know that 3/4 of the people would get rid of that state in an instant, and they want to know who's doing what. Why does our government feel such a need to collect information on its citizens?
Well, nominally, it's a post-9/11 phenomenon, and it's a national security set of questions. And one of the things that we've seen in these recent years is a kind of amplification of arguments based on national security for wider and wider nets gathering data. Is there a particular need? There may not be. But the idea is because they can, they will pursue all this knowledge. And quite possibly, the incentives line up for more people within government to classify documents, people in government to classify documents that might just reflect badly on government itself. So it may not be the particularized need that you're talking about to repress radicals, but rather simply to safeguard the current administration with the potential to ultimately stop terrorism or terrorist acts or something along
those lines. So I'm trying to get into the mind of the movers and shakers of the surveillance state. And what is it that they're thinking about this nation on whose behalf? I mean, one thing they might think, I mean, especially the post-9/11 world, they might think it's a really ugly world out there. And there are all these people who, I know you grew up in New York City, right?
Yep.
There are all these people who, if they could get a suitcase bomb and take it into your neighborhood where you grew up, they would do it in an instant.
Yeah.
They want nothing more than to do that. And the government says, we got to find out who those people are. So that they may think of themselves as like doing the dirty secret work that has to be done in our name. I mean, what do you think of that?
That's exactly what they think they're doing. And in fact, there are some arguments that support that. So two of the hijackers were in San Diego, the 9/11 hijackers, and they were making calls to an Al-Qaeda safe house. Had those calls been intercepted and tracked back, you know, here's the counterfactual. We don't know how it would have played out, but quite possibly, you know, 9/11 could have been thwarted. This is documented in the 9/11 report. But does that then justify these enormous data gathering projects, right? So the particular need seems manifest. It seems obvious to us, right? But the longer term, I'm not sure. And the wider net, you know, that's the problem.
John,
I mean, even if we say, well, you know, if it's for the public good, do it. Mm-hmm. What I said about the airliner, the point wasn't just to make a macabre joke. It was that with all the money we spend on stuff that isn't saving any lives or doing any good, and then we're not even spending the money to keep track of airliners. But think what we could do just in the U.S. Many more people die of car accidents than all the terrorist acts multiplied by 100 that have happened since 9/11. Every new car could have an emitter in it that told the state police when it was going more than 70 miles an hour or was swerving, right? They could do that. That would save a lot more lives than listening in on Ken's phone calls to his wife.
But that would transgress our right to speed.
That would transgress our right to speed. Every gun could have a little transmitter in it so that when somebody's killed by gunfire, they have... one more way to track it down. There's a lot of things that, if we're going to, I mean, my gripe is, if we're going to have all this information society and surveillance, let's at least focus on the things that are real dangers, and not every Muslim that gets on a plane.
Wait a minute, though, John. I think you're actually making it there. Look, we have this democracy with this amazing constitution, sometimes trampled, but it's an amazing document. Yeah. And our Fourth Amendment, as I understand it, gives us a pretty sweeping right that not many countries emulate, right? And look, the reason we don't do all that stuff is because that's so obviously a violation of the Fourth Amendment. It's so obviously, and whatever the government interest is, that Constitution says, you can't do this. But there's a deep, I don't think it's a trivial question, right? There are people who want to bring a suitcase nuclear bomb into New York City or San Francisco or Portland, and they want hundreds of thousands of Americans to be irradiated and die. That's what they want, right? And this government of ours wants to stop it. They can't violate the, well, maybe they are violating the Constitution, but they're tiptoeing, at least they think of themselves as tiptoeing up to the edge of what's permissible in our name. They think they're doing this in our name. Snowden thought they weren't doing this in our name at all. But I do think they think they're doing this in our name, and they couldn't do what you're saying, because the Constitution clearly prohibits
it. Well, I don't know. I don't think it clearly prohibits having a sensor on your car. I mean, if they can use radar to find out how fast people are going, and airplanes, I don't think they get the guns.
Well,
guns are another matter.
I think.
But
yeah.
Leaving you out of it for
okay,
a minute.
Okay, fine. You guys go.
I just don't want to let all this blarney about our glorious Constitution to go unchallenged. Our glorious Constitution that's heading us into a train wreck of a 21st century, while countries without constitutions like Britain do just fine.
Oh, yeah, but, yeah. I was just making.
What do you think about
that? I was just making the point that the Fourth Amendment is a pretty glorious thing.
It is, except it hasn't yet gone to the level where we have ascertained some of the points that you were making earlier, right? Mm-hmm. So, do you own your Facebook posts? Does that count as an effect under the Fourth Amendment? Mm-hmm. Same thing with your cell phone signals that travel through the air, or Twitter, right? Mm-hmm. And this gets, I think, your connection as well, right? The lobbies are what's different. What's different in getting knowledge out there to the wider public about the digital surveillance that's going on for all of us is that there's a very effective car lobby. There are very effective NRA, right, who can push these positions that they don't want surveillance of individuals. They don't want gun lists. They don't want changes to the infrastructure of automobiles in very particular ways. And we simply do not have a very effective lobby to push for our digital rights.
Well, you're listening to Philosophy Talk. We're talking about Big Brother having grown up, the new surveillance society, in front of a live audience at Oregon State University. We've got some questions from that live audience. Welcome to Philosophy Talk, sir.
Hi, my name is Matt Enlow. I'm a third-year philosophy student at Oregon State, and I'm interested to see what you guys think about the whole perspective that's being put forward. In my eyes, it seems that the preconceived notion is that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. However, the way that we go about these sorts of things is rather reactionary than preventive. What we do is we look for this information and react to it, rather than sort of working to create a society where those sorts of actions aren't necessary. By having these kinds of programs, it seems like we're being more predatory and violent and creating possible conflict than it is that we're working to fix the problems to begin with.
Yay!
And more investments of ideas, research, money seem to be causing more problems than they are solving.
Well, I would, it's hard to disagree with the overall premise, and I would think that, with regard to foreign policy, you might say that policies that look like there might be some kind of short-term game, but if you think about it, mean that thousands of more people in the next generations are going to hate us and want to do all the things Ken is talking about. That might be at least in the semi-long term, a good thing to throttle down on if we don't want to have the whole place burned up and blown up.
I would argue that basically that some of my students in the audience would probably back this up from their studies of American foreign relations. Virtually all U.S. foreign relations, and particularly wartime foreign relations related to intelligence, is reactive. It is reactive in exactly the way that you're describing. And it's very much about allocating enormous amounts of resources, sometimes to deal with rather modest threats. And so this is not unprecedented at all in U.S. history or world history. But the key question, I think, for us in thinking about this and problematizing this is that this is going on in wartime, and there are exceptional powers given to the commander-in-chief. And in terms of infringements of free speech rights in wartime that simply aren't permitted in peacetime. And we haven't really thought much about as a citizenry what it means to be in a perennial state of war now. It may well be that we'll be in a state of war against terror, against Al-Qaeda, for the rest of our lifetimes.
Well, if a war can be against kind of an abstract thing like terror, I mean, maybe we should have gone to war status when we started the war on poverty or the war on drugs. But I think you're right. When we've got, you know, I don't want to get too political here, but probably the most intelligent, liberal, grounded, sensible president that we've had in my lifetime, and he's kind of powerless to do anything about this drift towards Big Brother, it's kind of depressing.
Welcome to Philosophy Talk, sir.
Thank you. My name is Ben. I wanted to ask about self-censorship. Does knowing that we're being watched change how we behave or how we think?
You know, one thing that struck me very recently was that Jimmy Carter, in fact, ex-President Jimmy Carter, said that he is fully aware that the NSA and other intelligence agencies are surveilling his email. He prefers snail mail, although he knows it's photographed. And, you know, it could be, and I think this is echoing something that Ken and John have been saying, it could be that we need to turn back maybe even to some more antiquated walks in the woods, perhaps, right? There's a sort of model of self-censorship or more antiquated ways of communicating may render us less susceptible to the kind of panopticon of global surveillance.
You know, from a more general philosophical view, there's some really interesting questions there. Part of our of at least the Abrahamic religions, and maybe the other ones too, is there is a big brother watching us, right? I mean, if you were raised with Catholic grandparents like me, you would grow up with the feeling that God, or it's not Santa Claus, is keeping track of everything, and that was it affected a lot of what we did, and then there's this whole. Somebody said Nietzsche, one of those guys, Plato, I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, if God is dead, everything is permitted, Dostoevsky. So the idea of somebody watching us is written into kind of the fabric of our selfhood sometimes. And we'd be kind of uncomfortable if we didn't think at least some of what we do was somehow being recorded. Right? If not by St. Peter, I mean, presidents worry about their legacy and they try to control it. So the idea of having a pass, getting credit for the good things, worrying about not doing the bad things, it all depends in a way on a lack of privacy. And I don't have any answer to your question, but I think it's a really deep one.
Yeah, and it's a deep one. And I think Nietzsche should have said, God is dead, but Google lives. But welcome to Philosophy Talk there.
Hi, my name is Jana, and I'm a social worker. You started out saying that you're clear what the corporations' agendas are, so let's talk about government. But I'm thinking about the Supreme Court decision that was made today that echoes one that was made, 2 years ago, saying corporations are people. Today they struck down individual political donations, least a great part of them. And to me, I'm thinking maybe that line is really getting blurred. Maybe the government's agenda is being subsumed by the corporation agenda, and I wonder what you have to say about that.
You have something to say about that?
Sure. Well, I think it goes hand in hand. And here we could think about other intelligence gathering operations of the past. Some of the most important decisions recently have been about questions that we're getting at here, too. I think data gathering by Google, by Facebook, where do we want this metadata to be aggregated? I think we're likely to live with this for the foreseeable future. Would we rather Verizon has it, or Facebook has it, or the NSA has it?
That's a Hobson's choice. That's one of those damned if you do, damned if you don't.
How about AT&T? Because I've got stock, you know.
But the question about corporations then is how is it used? And so the NSA would want to use it the way that we're talking about to filter out people who might do harm. The corporations are using this to sell us products and to turn us into sort of informational people, to bit and bite-ize us into these sort of little aggregate pieces of data, which are actually harmful, which you can't avoid, which are easily tracked back to much more problematic information about you, about social security numbers and about politics.
You're okay. Listening. You're listening to Philosophy Talk. We're thinking about the new surveillance society with Christopher McKnight-Nichols, author of Promise and Peril.
Edward Snowden, traitor or heroic whistleblower? Satan or saint? Blowing in the wind or spitting into the wind? That's the question after this next break.
We're coming to you from Oregon State University in Corvallis. We'll take more questions from our audience when Philosophy Talk continues.
I will riff and then ask.
Okay. And then we'll take these.
The questions.
Okay.
Are you guys ready with the video camera? Okay. Everybody ready here?
Cool. Indeed, private eyes are probably watching you right now. Welcome back. I'm John Perry. This is Philosophy Talk, the program that questions everything.
Except your intelligence.
Hey.
I'm Trent Taylor. Our guest is Christopher McKnight-Nichols, historian here at Oregon State University in Corvallis, and we're thinking about how the new surveillance society, Big Brother grown up.
So let's think a little bit about Snowden. Now, I have a complaint about Snowden. His timing was way off, because if this gets settled by our current Supreme Court, it's hopeless. That's the Supreme Court that says that corporations are persons, that life imprisonment for a couple of ounces of marijuana is not cruel and unusual punishment, that says free speech means being able to buy up all the commercial time in America. So what's, you know, it's hopeless. There's a pattern there. There's a pattern there. They're crazy, right? But setting the Supreme Court aside, as we would all like to do, what kind of nerd is Snowden? A hopelessly naive nerd worried about violations of an out-of-date notion of privacy? An unpatriotic nerd disclosing secrets that imperil America? Or a valiant nerd, a heroic nerd, making a great attempt to stop America's slide into Big Brother society, a whistleblower we should all appreciate?
Clear that up, would you? What's history's verdict going to be?
Okay. Historians should know better than to pass historical judgment, but for the sake of the show, I'm willing to go for it. And I would venture to say that history will vindicate his leaks. I think that the binary of hero or traitor is a false one. We shouldn't buy into that. But the closest sort of historical parallel is probably Daniel Ellsberg and the Pentagon Papers. And for better and for worse, there are some real differences between the two. And very often in the public discussion, we've seen them elided. Ellsberg was leaking historical data, data that didn't have as much present in terms of present implications. What Snowden has leaked, only 1 or 2% is out yet. And that has ongoing and perhaps future ramifications. So we have to wait and see what happens regarding that, but it's quite likely that history will vindicate this.
I don't know what I believe, okay, but I'm going to put on a possible thought here, okay? I mean, Ellsberg, looking back at Ellsberg and the time and what the government was up to, there was a war that almost everybody now believes, there's still some people who hold out, but almost everybody now believes was insane and pointless. And we now say, you know, that war ought to have been ground to a halt. He didn't grind it to a halt, but there were all these people trying to grind that war to a halt. And you can kind of believe that if it had been ground to a halt earlier, I mean, look, the war ended up with Vietnam going high and the world, the dominoes didn't fall. It was an insane, pointless war. It's not so clear to me. I don't know what the War on Terror really is or all that sort of stuff. It's not so clear to me that it's an insane and pointless thing. And now, maybe Iraq was an insane, pointless episode in the so-called War on Terror. But this whole thing of trying to stop global terror from wreaking havoc on the American shores, that's not so clearly insane and pointless to me right now.
But it could be that taking all of our digital information, the capacity to store that forever, is in fact just as insane and pointless. And at some future date, this data could be searched and used in ways that we don't foresee today. And that's probably the deepest and most problematic issue at stake there.
Let's take some questions. We got lots of them. Welcome to Philosophy Talks. I'll go back and forth one side to the other.
Hi, I'm Peter. My question is, we've heard a number of legal or political or pragmatic reasons for why there must be a right to privacy. What is the philosophical grounding for the claim that individuals have such a right to privacy in particular?
Well, look, the state is a voluntary thing. And ask yourself, if you were in what Rawls called the original position, right, behind the veil of ignorance, you're going to empower the state, or Locke and Hobbes and those guys thought as the state of nature, and you were going to surrender. I mean, the state doesn't start out with a right to rule you. Its legitimacy is through the, as Jefferson says, through the consent of the governed. So you're going to give up something to this state. Would you give up to a state willingly and voluntarily all aspects of privacy? Probably not. Probably a condition of the legitimacy of a state, of a democratic state, as opposed to a totalitarian illegitimate state, is that it respects spheres of individual action, individual will, individual choice, and privacy is all bound up with that.
But notice, I mean, there are kind of more absolute things, maybe coming from the libertarian point of view. If you take the Rawlsian approach, then you have to, the Rawlsian approach is behind a veil of ignorance, that is, you don't know who you're going to be, or even when you're going to live, or what kind of job you're going to have, or whether you be male or female, and you make rules that will be binding to everyone, so you don't want to make rules that will kill you if you end up being, one thing or the other. So yes, that's a pretty good idea. But you also don't know what the situation is going to be like. And suppose one of the things you had to consider behind the veil of privacy is suppose you were in a situation as Israel conceives itself to be, and as we're coming to conceive ourselves to be, you know, a state in peril of terrorist activity, mass destruction, so forth and so on. And the alternative was that you could give up the right to privacy in return for a guarantee that the state would not abuse this and would just use it to protect everybody. If you think the right to privacy is absolute, it doesn't make sense to give it up. But under the veil of ignorance, it might make sense in a situation like we take ourselves to be.
Well, and I think that gets at the real question here, that it isn't a purely philosophical question, right? That there's a practical component, and there is no absolute right to privacy that could function in the real world.
Mm-hmm. Welcome to Philosophy Talks, sir.
Hello, my name is Kevin. I'm a mathematics student here at Oregon State. And this is my opinion, and I was wondering, is your thoughts to it, that any whistleblower had thought about what they were going to do before they blew the whistle, right? And that because they did so, they exceeded a moral threshold for themselves, that they saw something that was not morally okay with them. And that in the eyes of the law, if you see a crime being committed and you don't do anything about it, you can be tried the exact same as the person who committed the crime, right? And I was wondering if you had the same opinion as, like, that it is a moral question and not only a legal one as to whether a person should be able to blow the whistle.
I think that's a very good question. I think it's a complicated question. I do think one may have the law is the law, but it's not morality. Morality may at some time supersede the law. One may have a duty. I mean, some laws are unjust, right? And so one may have a duty of morality to disobey or interfere with an unjust law. This is complicated stuff. On the other hand, the law isn't just, you know, a guy with a big stick. The law, if it's to command respect, has to command respect. So respect for the law is important yeah. element of the rule of law. You can't just give your finger to the law if you're going to live by the rule of law. So it's very, very complicated. And we could do a whole show yeah. on this kind of issue.
And historically, this is the crux of the problem. Ellsberg was tried on the Espionage and Sedition Acts of 1917 and 1918. It's only because of the overreach of the government looking through his psychologist's office that's thrown out of prosecutorial misconduct. So too, Snowden will most likely be tried on the same grounds. So there could be the moral imperative here, which is a higher one, to disclose something unjust, and at the same time, it could be illegal, right?
So they're being tried on a law that was passed during World War I.
Exactly.
One of America's really bad ideas, right? But the law hasn't gone away.
And that is the law that has tried virtually everyone, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, and a host of others for their
But I want to just balancing due respect for the law and the rule of law versus the demands of morality is not a simple thing, right? And moreover, individual conscience. There is individual conscience. But then individual conscience has to be conditioned and put against. If your individual conscience is just invincible, well, then that's a little problematic. But you can't abandon individual conscience. So it's a very complicated thing. Yeah. Welcome to a philosophy talk, sir.
Thank you. My name is John Dowd. I have two points I'd like for you to touch on, if you don't mind. And thank you for bringing up Insane and Pointless. Because the mythical suitcase bomb versus the actual 7,000 or more thermonuclear devices in our arsenal just seems crazy to me.
Yeah.
I mean, the difference between the two, one is something that I've been told about to be afraid of in the last 10 years. One I've been told to be afraid of for the last 55 years, 60 years. So my big concern is, how long do I have to be afraid of this mythical suitcase bomb that's never existed, doesn't exist today, when the whole fear around it could be completely dissipated with a small change in foreign policy? And I think you know what I mean regarding our position on Middle East culture.
Yeah, I mean, this. Do you want to jump in here?
Well, it's very difficult question to solve. I don't have any easy answers. If any of us did, we would be attempting to solve that problem. I mean, it strikes me that in some ways, the kind of exigencies of a wartime state, national security, are what this is all about. And it's no shock that the theme for today's program really coincides with 1945 to the present, right? So it's a Cold War phenomenon, the rise of the security state. The NSA is born in 52 under Truman. It hasn't gone away. It won't go away. These kinds of threats, you know, if it's a suitcase bomb, if it's anthrax, if it's chemical, biological, pick your poison there, literally. It will be a threat used to justify national security measures, and some of which are legitimate, right? There's no denying that there are people who want to attack the U.S.
And let's add something, right? So look, the two arsenals of the two, well, the one superpower and the one former superpower, which could blow the world up, except for us in 1945, they haven't been unleashed. There have been threats of their being unleashed. Because states constrain each other, right? Because states will do each other in or try to do each other in, and they have all these network of relations that they value as states. Here's the world we live in. Aroused individuals can organize themselves, non-state actors, transnationally, and they can do a lot of bad stuff. How does a state face those non-state actors, organized? You know, Israel's been dealing with this for a long time. I don't say they've always done good or bad. I'm going to be neutral about that on the air, right? But that's not a small problem, how a state deals with these empowered, enraged, non-state actors. It's not a small problem.
I just want to bring out a historical point here, what goes around and comes around. FDR was coming back from the Crimea, which was then part of Russia. Mm-hmm. And he stopped in the Middle East and visited the King of Saudi Arabia, and they shook hands. Said, "Oh, you give us a lot of oil, and we'll keep peace in the Middle East." right? A few years later, John Foster Dulles under Eisenhower, so that's the Sunnis, mm-hmm. You know, tries to deal with the Shiites by putting the Shah in charge in Iran. These seem like rather obvious things to do with no real worries when they were done, and now they're haunting us. So one general principle might be, when there's a 3,000-year-old complex religious war between people whose language you don't understand, keep the fuck out of it.
Thank God for editors. Should I take? Let me take this last question, because this is our first female voice over here.
No, second.
A second? Okay.
Yep.
Welcome to Philosophy Talk.
Probably not 3,000.
Thank you. My name's Elliot, and I'm a student at OSU. I've been trying to think of what bothers me about when people get really angry about security, and what happened after Snowden leaked everything. This may be because I'm in my 20s, but I don't know anybody who gave up their phone or their email or, you know, did anything in response for their personal lives, because they really didn't care enough about that to give up the other things. So to what extent do we are we signing on to sort of a knowledge that this is happening when we use those technologies? Mm-hmm. And also, how can we have this, like, we have this dichotomy between us and the government, sort of, and the government is big and evil and Big Brother and everything. And if the government really does, you know, if I was an official, I might think that it was my responsibility to protect the people and all of that, and the people are also receiving benefits from this technology. So how do we reconcile those two things?
So you put your finger on really the major problem, the major challenge of our age. Do you read the consent forms that you sign on to for Google, for Facebook, for everything else? You know, no, nobody does. Has anybody actually read them? And so I had this one proposal. We were talking about this earlier, something new for the show. I think that what we need is something like a Surgeon General for digital information. It's been 50 years since the first smoking report of the Surgeon General in 1964. And it took, you know, really that long, two generations, to push back against entrenched lobbies and to give the kind of information to a wider public that then instantiated some social good. So maybe we need that sort of thing. So little snippets. We would know better what we're signing on to and why.
Well, Chris, that's a brilliant suggestion. We'll have to have you back to, like, dig into it a lot more. But on that note, we're gonna have to end this conversation on that brilliant suggestion. Our guest has been Christopher McKnight Nichols, professor of history here at Oregon State University, author of Promises in Peril, America at the Dawn of a Global Age. Thanks so much for joining us, Chris.
Thank you very much.